previous video, I've interviewed Steve Tufty Carver, a Woking resident with a great Paul Weller backstory. I wanted to know more about his Woking tour, so tracked him down in his local cafe.
Are you Tufty?
You sure again? I know you. What now?
So, Tufty, you do tours of Woking, showing Paul Weller's history and background. Are you happy to show me round?
Well, yeah, I've got a couple of hours now, I suppose, yeah.
Okay.
Are you going to buy me dinner if I do this?
I'll buy you a drink.
Done. This is Paul's childhood infant home. I didn't know it till this year. Nikki asked to come on the tour and we stopped there and I went, what are we doing here, Nick? And she went, this is where Paul was a little babby, in this very house here. There it is.
And the road is Walton Terrace.
Walton Terrace leading the Monument Way West. Our school was called Monument Hill. Yeah. I imagine, yeah, that was Paul's childhood home, and then they eventually ended up in Stanley Road. It may as best to explain here. This was Paul's house, Stanley Road. This was the Woking Liverpool Club, where the Jam played. That was Woking Working Men's Club, where the Jam played. Where the blue building site is was Woking Youth Centre, where the Jam rehearsed. So in a weird way, Paul lived there, he played there, and rehearsed, literally 50 yards apart. The Liberal Club eventually closed down. I think the Jam were banned from playing that because Steve Brooks stood on top of a piano. So the Liberal Club closed down. The Working Men's Club weirdly become the Liberal Club. They're all closed down now, and as you can see, the Youth Centre has also gone. As much as I can remember, the Working Men's Club, the entrance, I reckon they've copied it. Almost exactly, that was the entrance to the Woking Working Men's Club. As I said, that was Woking Youth Centre, or Territorial Armwood Centre. That's where they rehearse. So literally, house, gig, rehearsal, 50 yards. Seems like a mad world now. Amazing bit of luck on my part. They eventually got knocked out of Stanley Road because they were being demolished or something. Moved into my back garden the summer of 1976.
Okay.
Well, this is Balmore Drive. This is where Paul lived. This is Balmore Drive. Funny story about this. Paul used to live around the corner around there, but more or less where we're standing now. I don't know if any of you lot remember. Do you remember the Page 3 girl, Jilly Johnson? She lived in one of these houses. I can't remember which now. So Jilly Johnson and Paul Weller both went to Shearwater School. So they become famous for different reasons, obviously. As Jilly Johnson become more and more famous, every single one of my friends used to say to me, I went out with her, and eventually I worked out, according to them, I was the only person in the school who never went out with Jilly Johnson, the famous Page 3 girl. But she lived here. So yes, Balmore Drive, the home of Paul Weller and Page 3 girl, Jilly Johnson. Google it.
And how old was he when he lived here?
Paul moved in, he was about 18. I think I was about 20 when he turned up round here. The summer of 1976. As I say, we started seeing the Sex Pistols, 100 Club and The Clash, same bill, 50p. 1976, and then things happened really quickly. I think did the Jam get signed? Probably March 1977, something like that. And that was it. The roller coaster started. It seemed to me then The Pistols stopped playing really quick for whatever reason. Either they weren't allowed to play, McLaren didn't want them to play. I think the Clash become cool very quick, so they didn't play for whatever reasons, which meant that left the Jam. And literally, the way I remember it, 1976, 77, 78, it was four times a week. You know, it was Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday. It was relentless. You know, John being a good old working class boy, I just don't think he turned gigs down. We would take gigs here, there and everywhere. You know, I remember playing a pub on Christmas Eve, 1976 Christmas Eve, playing a pub in Farnborough. I remember distinctly, you know, playing it to a Christmas Eve crowd rather than a rock and roll crowd.
How did they like it though?
They pulled the plug on them. I remember literally, actually, the guy, I've told the story before, we turn up the tumble down dick in Farnborough, everyone's having a fantastic time, you know, everyone's dancing the Gary Glitter and Slade and the Rubettes and whatever it was in the charts. And then there's a raffle and everyone's having a good time. And then the manager of the pub got up on stage and went, right, ladies and gentlemen, as a special Christmas Eve treat, we've got a young up-and-coming band from Woking. Put your hands together for the Jam. Obviously, they walked on stage, started playing their own songs. You know what it's like. No one gets up and dances to a group. After about three songs, the manager pulled the curtains on them, pulled the plug, and everyone else got up and started dancing the Wizard and Sweet or whatever it was.
Slade.
And on the way home, so that was Christmas Eve 1976, on the way home, Paul said, that's the last fucking time we play any of them gigs. Because you've got to remember what you're doing in them days, probably playing the Marquee and the 100 Club and the Roxy and the Vortex, you're getting paid a tenner, which doesn't even cover the petrol. Whereas if you played a pub or a function or a party, you're getting whatever, 100 quid. So the parties and the pubs and the christenings and the weddings were subsidising the 100 Club and Roxy gigs.
Yeah.
But eventually, you know, Paul being Paul, you've got to go, right, are we seriously going to do this now? And as far as I can remember, Christmas 1976, that's it. January the 1st, 1977, now this is a proper band. And yeah, that stuff's got to stop. In the city, there's a thousand things, and people, you know what it's like. You've all been in the pub, a band trying to get people to dance. They just don't dance. People are scared to dance to human beings. But it all worked out well in the end. So the folklore about this place, if you've ever read the book War of the Worlds by H.G. Wells, he was living in Woking at the time when he wrote it, and the location we're going to go to now, we always called the sandpits. It's a clearing in the common. H.G. Wells, in his imagination, thought that's where the Martians landed. When you see it, it makes absolute sense. So all the pubs in the War of the Worlds book are actually named pubs in Woking, because he used to drink around Woking. But later on, the Jam film Funeral Pyre here. So people used to write me and go, how do I find the location for Funeral Pyre? And my answer is, always ask a local where the Martians landed and you'll find the exact spot.
So it's opposite a disused pub.
It used to be the Bleak House. I used to go and see groups here, and then they changed it to Sands Restaurant. And unfortunately, like most pubs, it's closed down now. Like a lot of places in Woking closed down. This is it. This is the location for Funeral Pyre Video. We built a bonfire in the middle there. The Jam set up and played in the shadow of the bonfire. However many years ago, 1981 was it? Wow. When we were kids, as we used to dig caves in the wall. It was a lot more sheer, but we used to dig caves in the wall. But like I say, they've levelled it out into a bowl now. So the other game we used to have in the winter was see who could ride a bike through the lake. But obviously when you get older, common sense tells you, you run out of steam in the middle of the lake and just fall over. So, you know, kids being kids, they were our games, yeah. If you go on YouTube or Google, you can get a picture of Mark Kermode holding a blue plaque up saying War of the Worlds was filmed here. I think the blue plaque might have ended up in the pub we just saw, so it's kind of gone forever. But yeah, there was this, because I think 2 years ago they filmed a new version of War of the Worlds here, didn't they, or something?
I think,
but
yeah.
It wasn't very good. I give up halfway.
It's like being at the seaside.
Yeah, this is Woking sand pits. Everything in Woking had nicknames, and this was it, the sand pits. As I said, though, they were sheer cliff faces. We used to dig in the cliff face. You know, like, just scary. Scary what you do when you're kids.
Beautiful, though, isn't it?
Yeah, it's a lovely setting. And I always say my favourite tree in the world is that tree there, because you can see how trees are made.
You can see all the roots.
The root, yeah, there's much more underground than there is at the top, yeah. But you know where we sat and had a coffee just now?
Yeah.
There's a pillbox on the canal bank there.
Is there?
Yeah. So, and I don't know how... Are they expecting Germans to come up the Basingstoke Canal? I don't know how these things work. Nice, isn't it?
Yeah.
Well, that's nice. Well, that's
nice.
Now we've got to find a way back.
So a lot of people have left Woking. Obviously, Paul doesn't live here, Nikki doesn't live here. Rick still lives local, I think.
Yeah, Rick lives around here. Paul's studio's obviously still around here. I think Bruce lives in Guildford or somewhere. Yeah.
I mean, you enjoy living where you do here?
I've lived here all my life. It's the first time in my life I've maybe got itchy feet, but timing, innit? See what happens in the future. I don't know. You've got to think where you want to go then, haven't you? I want to live at the seaside.
So do I.
Yeah, this is the Princess of Wales in Maybury, which is, you know, the nearest pub to me and Paul's house. This is where it all happened. This is where we met every night. This is where we met our friends from Shearwater to go to the Roxy or the Marquee. Or this is where we just analysed the gigs. This is where we plotted world domination for the Jam. And happy to say it really worked out. It worked out a treat, as they say. This was the first time I ever met Paul, probably summer of 76. Walked into this pub, introduced myself, said to Paul, you're my new neighbour. And within seconds, we hit it off. And, you know, started talking about music, football, beer, girls, the Sex Pistols, punk rock, and never looked back. That was it. Started a journey. And on it went. So this is where we lived. That's Windsor Way, where I lived, and this is Balmoral Drive, where Paul lived. For some reason, all the streets are named after royalty. There's royal connections. Princess Gardens, Kent Road, Beaufort Road, Windsor Way, Balmoral Drive. This was our row of shops, the chip shop, etc. Chip shop was at the end, and this used to be our newsagent, the Surrey shop. Unfortunately, there's no newsagent now, but this is where I used to buy my record mirror, disc, melody maker, sounds, on the way to visit Paul to eventually read about the gigs.
I guess that's where Paul got his NMEs.
Yeah, well, yeah, this is where Paul at 18 would be buying his music papers. And I used to buy them there, walk around to Paul's house, we'd sit on his doorstep and read the reviews or analyse the gigs. It was always sitting on his doorstep analysing the gigs. How was last night's gig? And unbelievably, obviously...
Analysing
last night's gigs.
What, the gigs they'd done? Or?
Yeah. Well, you know, go around, you know, we'd play Friday or Saturday and I'd go around for Paul Sunday and sit on the doorstep and you know, talk the gigs over. How's it all going like it was?
So here we are, this is the shop today. So what was this before when you were a kid growing up?
My mum used to work in here. This used to be Wavy Light, one of them, it was the greengrocer shop.
Okay.
Yeah, about 50 years ago, I suppose my mum used to work. We used to hang about at the fish shop because the fish and chip shop at the end, he kind of had a youth club out the back with pinball machines and a jukebox.
Did he?
So we smelt of fish and chips all the time. Yeah, Ted his name was, Ted's Place Fish and Chip Shop. And he had about four pinball machines, one arm bandits and a jukebox, and you just stayed there all night. And if you had the record on the pinball machine, you used to get £1 at the end of the week. So if you got 23,000 on Kings and Queens or Buckaroo or whatever the pinballs were called, he used to write on the blackboard. Of course, the incentive was everyone kept playing to try and better that score. And at the end of the week, the lucky winner got £1 or a bottle of Corona or something. Good scam.
It's changed a bit since you were here, though,
hasn't it? Changed a bit. Yeah, my mum used to work in this one. You used to just sit on that bollard and then go and buy fish and chips. My goodness.
So it's all changed.
Well, and changed structurally, but
the actual
everything else has changed. Yeah.
And so when this was the youth club, unofficial youth club.
Unofficial, yeah.
Did it have the no ball games then, or was that new? See where it says above there?
Yeah, did we play football in them days? I don't know. I just remember sitting out here all the time, or sitting there, then going in there, buying Pepsi, playing pinball machines. But I know Ted hated the Hare Krishna song on the jukebox. So if you put Hare Krishna on, he used to reject it. But literally, as I'm talking about it now, I remember playing Gary Glitter on the jukebox. How wrong is that?
Oh dear.
Paul obviously moved out, but his mum and dad lived in Balmoral Drive for a long time, and as ridiculous as maybe it sounds now, the Setting Sun's sound effects tour of 1980 set off from outside their house. It's quite a modest council house, and believe it or not, and it is hard to believe now, the pop star coach set off from outside that house. As mad as it seems, it's still there. So that was it. So this is Windsor Way. Paul lived in Balmoral Drive. The geography of it, we lived in the house there, number 35. To get to Paul's house, literally jumped over the back garden gate, run across the garden and knocked on his back door. That's how it worked. And as a strange side issue, number 31 compared to our 35 is where Neil Bomber Harris lived, who for a little while was the drummer in the Jam. So he was... whether he was the, I suppose he was the original drummer before they hit the big time.
Yeah.
This is kind of, again, part of our playground. Our school was at the other end of the canal bank, so if you weren't sporty, if you didn't like cricket or didn't like football and you never got picked for the school team, the get-out clause was, I'll go, can I run along the canal bank, sir? So all the lazy kids run along the canal bank, stopped at the sweet shop, the chip shop or the cigarette shop, sat around here for half an hour and then went back to school. So this was kind of part of the playground. sort of cleaning all the brickwork up, and I said to the guys, you're not going to... God, I hope they haven't done it. I said, you're not going to clean all the graffiti off, are you? Because everyone in Woking put their autograph on the bricks. I'm scared now that they've done it. It didn't used to. So, all the graves have been taken out, and I think each tree represents a grave. So the dead bodies have been moved, and now we've got trees.
So go on, tell me, how many tours do you think you've done over the years?
God, I don't know. You know, I suppose 30, 40, 50, I don't know. Some people turn up on their own, and I've done big groups, and we've done coaches. Yeah.
And you spoke about it in London as well. You spoke about...
Yeah. It's been about 12 years now, I suppose. So, yeah, you forget. Sometimes I'll get a good week, and like four people are... I'll do four in a week or something. Then you'll have months without doing anyone. Yeah.
And then I turn up.
We had a girl from Italy come and a guy from Bahrain. As stupid as that, you know, I say, you haven't come all the way from Italy or Bahrain for this. No, but we've heard about it and that's how it works. Yeah, who would have known, yeah. Part of my story, when I was 21, I just decided I didn't want to work anymore. So luckily, I got some redundancy money and I decided not to work, which was great for a year. And then they called me in to the Dole office and the lady said to me, you don't appear to be looking for a job. And I said, no, well, I don't think I am looking for a job, which didn't go down too well. And I think they cut my money. So I got off my arse and I went, weirdly, I got a job start Monday at a factory called EMI, of all things, in Shearwater. So I got a job. I went home and told my dad. I said, I've got a job. He went, well, it's about time. He said, you've been out of work for a year. And so, okay, I got a job. And then I went to Drown My Sorrows. I remember I was walking down the road to Drown My Sorrows. I really, really didn't want to go to work. And as luck would have it, as I was walking down the road, John Weller tooted his horn and shouts at me, Tufty, have you got a job yet? And I went, well, who wants to know, John? He went, well, do you fancy coming on tour and selling t-shirts for the lads? And of course I snatched his hand off. So I had a couple of pints. I had to go home and say to my dad, bless him, I said, Dad, I'm not taking the job. I said, I've been offered a job selling t-shirts for the Jam. And of course my dad said to me, well, how long's that gonna last? And I said, well, it's a month on tour. And so my dad said to me, so you're turning down a lifetime career at EMI to sell t-shirts for a pop group for a month? Which I did. I did. But hey,
you did it a bit longer than a month, though,
yeah,
didn't you?
Yeah, you know, we had jobs. Me and my brother used to sort of change hands. He'd do it, I'd do it, he'd do it, I'd do it. But you know, jobs come and go, but you're not offered a job with the Jam every day of your life. So I had a month on the Sound Effects tour. 42 years ago, as we speak, I was on tour doing the Jam, the Sound Effects tour, watching the Jam every night, travelling on the tour bus with them, staying in the same hotels, seeing them play every single note, getting pissed afterwards, and getting paid. The girl, we were... When John come on stage and announced the band, put your hands together for the best band in the fucking world, we used to just slam the suitcase lid down. All the kids would be going, well, we want to buy a T-shirt. And me and Jill will say, no, you can't buy T-shirts when the Jam are playing. You've got to watch the band. And, you know, that was the rule. So then me and Jill would go and stand at the side of the stage, watch the concert, open the suitcase afterwards and sell T-shirts then. I remember the promoter saying to us, how much money did you make at Hammersmith Odeon? We'd say, oh, we made £2,300. And I remember the promoter, go, well, you know, like Judas Priest make £6,000 when they sell Hammersmith. And I go, yeah, but they sell like belts and badges and leather jackets and stuff like that. And to be honest, it wasn't about selling t-shirts. I don't think it was ever about selling t-shirts. They might disagree. It was about watching the best band in the world. Get your t-shirt afterwards, watch the group, you can buy a t-shirt later. That was it. We'll be right back.
for some no commemorations for the new age sand. Tears of praise roll down your face, but still you say it's fine.
This is where me and Paul filmed something else for the BBC. So they've done a jam concert in here. The way the jam were at the, you know, when at the end of their career, they strangely played a lot of local gigs. I remember one mad weekend they played a pub, the YMCA, and this place in one weekend. And that was when they were at the height of their game, probably 1981, 1982. So they, you know, Dave Strike, I think the jam for a while rehearsed here. Dave Strike was a youth leader, and Paul always used to give back when he could. So not only did they play benefit gigs here, that we filmed the Something Else TV program in this building. One of my, probably the first time I ever come across the jam, There was a talent show in Woking, which eventually became a nationwide talent show. And I think some of my school friends were in a different band whose name escapes me. And I weirdly took photographs of them doing the audition. I think it was here. So I photographed them. Then, zooming on, Steve Brooks was telling me the other day that the jam got to their local heat. And they were up against a Teddy Boy group who strangely had appeared in the film That'd Be The Day. So the Teddy Boy group said to Brooksy and Paul, you've got no chance winning this because we are already in a feature film starring David Essex. The jam beat them. Then, as Brooksy goes on to say, that probably didn't do them any favours because their ego went through the roof, and the way he remembers it, they got knocked out the next round by a juggling dog or something like that. Now, the strange bit about this situation was one of my bosses at work, by the time the local heats become big, they were held in local cinemas. So I saw my welding boss at the time singing Frank Sinatra's My Way at the Odeon Cinema in Woking. So eventually this opportunity knocks X Factor type thing back in the 1974, something like that. It eventually became a nationwide talent show. God knows who won it, but here's the weird thing about it was, the auditions or the rounds were coincided with the release of a Best of MGM musical film, a Gene Kelly type film, and the film was called That's Entertainment. So weirdly, history repeating itself, the gigs were all held in the middle of a film called That's Entertainment. As strange as that seems. And here we are. Shearwater Youth Club Woking. Don't go in that entrance. Yeah, I still see Brooksy occasionally. He plays guitars in pubs in the area.
Steve Brooks,
yeah. And funny enough, the other day, we were talking about the Style Councillors playing Woking Football Club. He turned up as a support for that gig, but at the last minute he said his throat had fallen to pieces. So instead of playing songs, he was reading extracts out of his book, which was wonderful, which just tags on to the story I told about the That's Entertainment talent show. But yeah, he's got good stories to tell.
What's the book called?
I think it's called Keeping the Flame, but weirdly, it was a charity, so Style Council's played, Stevie Brooks played, or read his book, and he auctioned one of his books, because he said they're really rare now. Apparently, he lost them all, and they turned up in the Far East, and they go for 70, 80, 90 quid on eBay nowadays.
Really?
So he signed his that day. He said, he's one of my few remaining, I've lost my copy. He signed one of his few remaining books, and it's probably got 100 quid for it. And it was a great day, because after the Style Councillors play, Nicky got up and I don't know, I suppose the money was for a local charity, and they were auctioning off loads of programs and posters and photographs, and it was wonderful because one guy bought a Style Council program, and he got Nicky to sign it because Paul had already signed it, Mick Talbot had signed it, and wonderfully he said to Nicky, I actually went to this gig, but I've got a program which had been in my back pocket, but now because of you I've just bought a program signed by your brother and Mick Talbot and yourself and your mum, and I just love it, things like go full circle like that. People are still interested, you know. One of the girls there, I know she had bought a True Meanings, a framed photograph, a framed poster of True Meanings. Sue, her name was. And I went, Sue, did you buy that poster? And she went, yeah. She paid 200 quid for it or something. And she went, I bought it from my brother. She said, but now I've seen it, she said, I've just got to keep it. And, you know, 200 quid to have a lovely signed poster in your kitchen, you're going to look at it a lot. And it was lovely, yeah. It was a great night, by the way. And like I say, to see the Style Councillors play Woking Football Club, where like I say, me and my friends say this all the time, the stars align. And here we are 45 years later and the stars are still aligning. So this is where the Solid Bomb video was filmed. And I'm always saying to the manager of the football club, you know, because there's lovely photographs of Paul and Mick Talbot going through them doors. And I just say to the guy, I can't work out why you haven't got a blue plaque, because you get away supporters every week and they go, wow, does this all happen here? But the other day a bloke said to me something along the lines of, well, some people are a bit sniffy about Paul because he sort of slags off Woking in a town called Mallis. There, so they're maybe there at that. Disappointing, but hey, yeah.
Where the filming of the video was.
This is where Harry Crowley on the DJ decks and all the dancers and Paul and Mick gooning about all them years ago. This is the actual place. Like I say, I just can't work out why they, you know, along with their football shirts, why they just don't, you know, get a fake blue plaque or a nice black and white picture to sort of commemorate it. But hey, maybe they think Paul don't represent Woking. But I come here the other week, the Style Council has played here. So I come to watch them with Paul's sister and Paul's mum. And I just said, it must be like playing Graceland to you. And they were really chuffed. And they stood there and played a whole Style Council set. Lovely.
Ooh.
Like, from our school, Shearwater School, these are our local shops, obviously all coming down now. Yeah, this is where we used to hang about after school. And again, another news agent bites the dust. So we were going to buy an enemy or a melody maker, but it's all coming down, as you can see. That used to be the Birch and Pines pub. Yeah, a few years ago, live on Facebook, a guy turned up here with his spray cans, and over a weekend, he done this nice tribute to Paul, which is a couple of hundred yards from the school we all went to, Shearwater School. The whole place is being demolished now. I have been told by the lady who runs all the local music stuff that she hopes to save it, and hopefully it does turn up somewhere, because it's a nice touch.
Oh, what's that? Chair. What's the chair?
Yeah, I'm afraid this is welcome to Woking. Well, this is it. This is Woking's tribute to the Jam. It kind of ruined it all for us, really, because we wanted a blue plaque or a statue or a plinth or something, but in their infinite wisdom, Ideal Homes paid for this. Apparently, they asked some local school kids to design a monument to Woking's most famous pop group, and I imagine some kids with crayons done a picture and they converted it, and this is what we got. Let's have a look.
I think Nikki's got a name for it. She said they've got their own nickname.
Yeah, right. It's Pole Weather, Spruce Foxton, and Twig Buckler, or Stick Buckler, maybe. Yeah. We all come here and watch Rick unveil it, because they seem to keep it top secret, and we all turned up to watch Rick unveil it, and they got the mayor of Woking. And he said, ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together for a tribute to the Jam. Rick pulled a bit of rope and a tarpaulin fell down, and we all started clapping, and then it just descended into, what the hell is that meant to be? And, you know, I said, Rick, which one's you, Rick? And he said, well, I'm at the back, obviously.
If you're enjoying this, smash that like button. And if you want to see hours of content that's similar to this, then check out the rest of my channel. What can you see? Well, there's interviews with old school hip hop artists. There's interviews with electronic musicians. There's even some punk.
Your shit, fuck off.
Plus there's stuff on records, vinyl, and other pop culture stuff. So subscribe to the channel, hit the notification bell so you don't miss any future stuff, and do what's right. Subscribe.
Subscribe to the Skyaaz YouTube channel.
And that's it, 45 years later, here we are still talking about him, still relevant. Long live the Jam and Paul Weller'S.